single hour to your inner life? And why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin, yet I tell you, even Solomon, in all his glory, was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? Therefore do not worry, saying, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear? For it is the Gentiles who strive for all these things, and indeed, your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But strive first for the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Here ends the lesson. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Almighty God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight. O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. And everybody take a deep breath. Let it out. Let's take another deep breath. Let it out. All right, everybody get up and move one seat to the right or the left.
Came to the New World from November
And of the 47 that survived, only 6 or 7 were healthy enough to keep the colony going from January until March. Very sobering thought. The pilgrims, after they made it through that first winter, were befriended by Squanto. Y'all know Squanto? Squanto was one of the indigenous peoples in this land, one of the Native Americans that were here before us. And Squanto took these religious refugees in and taught them how to live off the land, how to survive, how to grow crops, how to harvest them in. And a relationship developed between the Patuxent people and the pilgrims. And by Thanksgiving the following year, by November of the following year, the harvest was plentiful enough that for 7 days, the Patuxent and the pilgrims got together and they had a joyous feast to celebrate all the blessings that God had given to them, that the Creator had bestowed upon them. So much so that working together, they were able to survive, they were able to set food aside for the winter to come, and they celebrated. And they celebrated. And that's what we remember this week, right? And then the story continues. And this is the part that's uncomfortable for any of us. The story continues in the sense that as we rooted ourselves deeper and deeper into the land, we got ourselves to a place where we started to take land from the Native American. We started to swindle. We started to teach them our bad habits, drinking, gambling, addictions. We eventually got to a point where we forced them off their land, walking churches. We got to a point where we then gave them land to say, here, this is yours, and then we built nuclear missile silos on that land and made them ground zero. And there was a choice made somewhere along the line in that lineage to do that. Maybe it was a conscious choice, maybe it was an unconscious choice. Maybe it was a choice dictated by the need to continue to accumulate and grow and prosper, to gain wealth, if you will. Those are facts of American history. Not making it up. Not spinning it. Those are the realities. And we wonder. Today's gospel lesson comes to us with Jesus teaching the people about how we look at the world, how we look at our lives, how we look at our possessions, our things, the things that are important to us. And Jesus has this habit, as we've talked about before, of taking things that seem really good on face value and then flipping them up. And in this case, we hear this lesson, and it's a great lesson for the week of Thanksgiving. Don't worry about your life. Don't worry about the food on your table. Don't worry about the clothes on your back. Don't worry about what you need to wear or what you're going to eat or where you're going to sleep. And then there's this beautiful discourse on the lilies of the valley and how they toil and spin and how the birds of the air fly free and they don't really think about it. All of those worries that burden us down. Remember last week we talked about worries? Being burdened down by worries? Yes, no, lost y'all. Okay, you're there? You're there. We talked about worry. Jesus teaches them not to worry. It's a great lesson for Thanksgiving. Great lesson for Thanksgiving. However, the beginning of this text, in its fullness, in its full context, is this sentence. Is this sentence. A person cannot serve two masters. Okay? Either you'll love one and hate the other, or you'll be devoted to one and despise the other. Okay? You cannot serve God and wealth. That's the context of today's lesson. In its fullness, have served out our mouth. And we struggle with that, don't we? We want to be prosperous people. I'm not saying we want to have money in the bank, that's not what I'm saying. But we want to be prosperous people, don't we? We want to feel like we're blessed with enough. We want to feel like we have enough to do what we need to do to care for our families, to love the people around us, to be able to support and uplift one another, to be able to care for one another. And that's a struggle. For many of us, that's a struggle. Because sometimes it seems like there's not enough to get to the end of the month. Sometimes it seems like there's not enough to make ends meet. Some are more blessed than this, others are not. We do this in business. We do this in churches. Churches are notorious for this. I had conversations with members of three other churches this week. They're all in the same place because this is the season in the church's life where everybody hits this situation because it's budget time and it's look to the future time. You know, salaries, all those kinds of good things. And we all do this. We sit down, we look at what we have, and we say, how long will it go? And we look and we say, are we in the black or are we in the red? Most churches operate in the red, not secret. And they do that for a different reason than most businesses do. That's because they operate in faith rather than black and white. And so we find ourselves in these juxtaposition places where we're uncomfortable. Just in general, uncomfortable. And we go back to this conversation about the pilgrims, that first winter. You heard that conversation that there were 102 pilgrims on the Mayflower that first winter. They came over to Plymouth. In the first few months they were there, 50% of them died off. They were left with 47. And of the 47, 6 or 7 were the only ones who had the health and the ability to care for the rest of the colony. And the rest of the colony did what they could do to move to the spring, to try to survive to the spring. And I was looking through some statistics this week in conversation with leaders from two other places close by. And the statistics hold true. It seems to be that in churches in particular, about 10% of the membership of a church pull about 90% of the budget. Contribute 90% of the budget. Did you know that? Did anybody here know that? You've heard that statistic before. I know some of you have because I've heard you talk about it. You know that statistic before. Why? Because they're able to. Because there's a blessing there. There's a wealth there that some have, some don't. It's part of this whole notion of Thanksgiving. What Thanksgiving is this week. We look at what we have and we give out of our abundance. And we give out a blessing to God. And some have an abundance that's bigger than others. And you survive. If everybody commits to do their abundance, there's survival, there's blessing, there's more than survival, there's thanksgiving on the other side. Because all the needs are met. If those 6 or 7 leaders in the Plymouth Colony had said, you know what, this winter's too far, and everything is being taken away, we've lost half of our people, we don't know if we have enough to survive, and they said, now let's get back on a boat and go back to England, none of us would be sitting here. If the colonists as a whole, those 47, 48, said, you know what, it's time to throw in the towel, let's move, none of us would be sitting here. But they didn't. Why didn't they? They didn't because they had faith that together they could accomplish what they believed God had put them there for. A new land, a new vision, a new way of living, a new way of thriving and moving forward. Jesus teaches us things, God knows you need them, and they will show up. And they will show up. Anyone hearing Bobby McFerrin in your head? You should be. Don't worry, be happy. Anybody hear Bobby McFerrin? I'm going to let you hear Bobby McFerrin. Because I want you to hear this. This is Jesus' tone. This is not something that, you know, is just making light of the scripture this morning. Jesus teaches those crowds gathered there on the hillside to hear that in God's eyes, there's never too little. In God's eyes, there's always abundance. In God's eyes, if we walk in righteousness, then we don't need to get trapped in the stresses and worries of day-to-day living. We live the way God calls us to live, and we do what God calls us to do, and we don't worry. We don't worry. Hear it? And this is a hard place to be in. It's a hard place to let ourselves set things aside that make us uncomfortable, and together move in faith. Somebody sing along. Because there's the good news. The good news is that if we stop, then it's all fine. If we let ourselves get burdened down by our worries and cares, then there's no reason. We pack it all in now. This is true in daily living. You know, when you get into those situations in daily living, anybody have stress in your family? Anybody have stress in your family? I see some help. When you have stress in your family, there's two ways to react to it. I know, I have stress in my family. Real and extended. There's two ways to handle it. One is, you can get yourself all fired up about it. And then Thanksgiving and Christmas and any gathering that comes becomes explosive. Or you can say, you know what? Let's do our thing. Sometimes that means we're together, sometimes that means we're not. Sometimes that's good. But don't stress about it. Anybody? Anybody have stress on your job? Anybody have stress on the job? Yeah, I see people raising hands with stress on their job. We can burden ourselves down so much, worrying about the stresses of our jobs. But sometimes we lose sight of the things that are most important. Faith, our spirits. And then what do you do when you get to the church where it's all about faith and spirit? Well, we worry. We worry justified sometimes. I want to put that out there. Sometimes there's good reason to worry. However, we have to trust too that God is going to meet us where we are and carry us through. Because if we lose that piece of it, then anything else doesn't make sense. And we get ourselves all twisted in knots, and we sometimes lose our tempers. That's true. Sometimes we talk across each other and we don't understand what each other's saying. Sometimes we make some messes and we gotta clean them up. But the important thing is that we stay connected and in covenant and in faith, like those pilgrims. Because that's how you get to the vision that has been placed before us. That's how you get to the vision that has been placed before us. That whole notion that God will prosper us if we walk in faith. And in the meantime, we need to hear what Jesus is teaching us. We need to hear that knowledge. And we can't spend our time focused so much on the intricacies of all of that. We need to be doing what God calls us to do. And what is that? Reaching out to the poor, welcoming the unfriended, embracing those who have no voice, and celebrating the ways in which we have in our abundance the ability to bring the love of the gospel to others in need. And if we just do those things, then Thanksgiving is real in our individual hearts, in our families, in our churches. Because there is the celebration of abundance at the end. Now for those of you that worry, like me, okay? For those of us that get stuck in the needing things to be organized and in the right places, I heard this great story. I'm going to finish with this. I want you to hear this story. I want you to pretend your life is being led sitting on a bicycle with God. And on that bicycle, God is pedaling in the front and you're pedaling in the back. Anyway. Sometimes we need to let God just lead us. Over the hills, through the valleys, through the rocks. God knows which way to lead the bike. God knows how to get us through the muddy sand. God knows how to get us where we need to go. And in those times when we're not certain what we should be doing, we voice it, and we give it to God, and we trust God. Remember we talked last week about putting those papers in the thing on the door? And we trust God. And God